Hello, it's the wonderful, wonderful Dynamics 365 and Power Platform community. My throat is getting some energy back, and that's reflecting maybe in my voice towards the last leg of the journey. We're still coming in with action-packed kind of sessions, and one of our organizers come co-founding members at Dynamicity. 15 years of close to experience is going to be sharing something which is very, very cool and is not shared that often. So, okay, so there is some. All right, so we are going to have our session a bit earlier than planned. There's some video on there from somebody. Can it be turned off? I think that's a mistake. Anyways, coming back to the session. So our next session is from Mr. Vivek Patil. Let me give you an introduction to Vivek. Vivek is the person who I was first introduced to as the person credited to have 1,000 plus demos done with Microsoft India in a span of only 8 to 9 years. He's a veteran with Dynamics 365 and what we used to call CRM from the 3.0, 4.0 days. So there used to be a time when you'll not hear as much about Dynamics and business application space. I've had the privilege to work alongside him in the last 4.5 years and learned a lot also on the way. He's also one of the co-founding members at D365 Champs. His first session, though people choose to use a variety of mediums, I would like to introduce that his first session was on licensing, right? Which is a challenging topic for most people. That was his first session on community, just to go into history of when he started sharing his knowledge with us. Over to, if you have any queries, you can just share it with us in the chat window, and we'll try to take it either during the session, if Vivek has a pause over there, or we would like to take it towards the end. Along with me, co-moderating the session is Shalini, right? Over to you, Shalini, before you hand it over to Vivek.
So hello, everyone. Stay tuned. Vivek has some lot of insights about sales demo features for Dynamics 365 sales. So yeah, stay with us. Over to you, Vivek.
Okay, thank you. I'll just turn off my camera so that I get some good bandwidth. And I'll quickly go and share my screen. Let me know once you can see my screen. The other thing, I might be switching between these screens, and I might ask this again once in my session. So are you able to see the screen?
Yeah, Vivek, just a second. There's a user named Tala. Can you please try to turn off your cam? We are trying to get a full screen experience here, and we are getting a screen on or something is happening at your end. We will not be in a state to control the video. So if you can turn it off, that will be great. Thank you. Yeah, Vivek, we are able to see. Go ahead.
Okay. So good afternoon, good morning, or good evening from wherever you are joining. So today, first of all, thank you, D365 Champs, to give me a chance to present my session over here. So what we are going to see today is Sales Insight features. I will be majorly talking about premium features. Okay, there are some base features which are there, and now they have been enabled as part of default sales features, but we'll be focusing on premium features over here. About me, a lot more is explained by Dipesh and Shalini, so I'll not speak much about me. And the another good thing is because there are so many features that I want to show today, I'm getting some 10 plus minutes extra this session, so I might not need to run as fast as, so I'll take my own time. And if you have any queries, you can always ask into chat window, as people said. I'll be taking pause after every feature and asking for if you have any queries, so you can please raise your queries per session or at the end of the session as well. What is agenda for today? So we are gonna go through different features of Sales Insights. First is Sales Accelerator, then we have Sales Assistants, Productivity Features, Relationship Insights, and the Predictive Models. What is Sales Accelerator? Earlier, what used to happen whenever someone is using application, it used to look like only an application where we are just going dumping our data and trying to get some insights using not actually the insights as well, but some dashboards or charts or some kind of activities to be maintained. Now with the Sales Accelerator, what we get is Whenever we need a focused selling means whenever we want to identify which are the best opportunities or the leads where we have to work and which can be closed as early as possible. So that focused selling is what one of the need was in earlier features. Now, even what sales insights or sales accelerator allows us, it actually minimizes your time to identify such leads or opportunities, and that you get at the top of your application, which I'll showcase you. Now, how Sales Accelerator helps you? What it does, it gives you the prioritized list of such leads and opportunities where should be taken into consideration or actioned by the user. Now the users could be salespersons or the managers who are actually working on the records, and they can perform the said activities. Now these activities are actually the guided activities. Now what guided activities means, I'll explain you that as well. So these activities can be performed for better closure. As I said, the guided activities, like the application provides you what is the best next action to be worked on the lead or opportunities. Now, who and how this can be defined? So organization wide, there can be some processes or sequences that are that can be defined, or if there is a huge business where there are so many departments, so many users, so even managers can go and define their own sequences in the application, and that can be followed by the users. So this is what we are gonna look into the Sales Accelerator. I'll take through all the features first so that I can actually get into demo, and I'll showcase each and every part. The second thing is the sales assistant, where it has two parts. One is the base insight cards and the custom insight cards. Base insight cards you might have seen, still I'll run through what base insight cards are. And the second part is the custom insight cards, where if we have any custom requirements to share the notifications with the users or the managers within the application, so how that can be designed or developed and how they look like, so that will be showcased. Then about the productivity features. So there is three features. One is auto capture, where it gives an activity suggestions for the customer activities, and you can actually work on that suggestions. These are majorly on the email activities, which are email and appointments or the meetings from the Outlook or Exchange Online, and how it can be worked upon, that will be showcasing. The another part of productivity features is email engagement, where there was a very common ask from the users that how we can go and identify whether email is reached to the customer or not, whether customer has read the email or not. There was some links that were mentioned, whether they were clicked or not. So these features earlier used to be only part of your marketing solutions, but Microsoft has introduced that as a part of your sales insights features, as a part of email engagement. So where you can go and track certain emails that onto you, whether you want to track that particular email or not. So that kind of email engagement is another feature. Third thing is the notes analysis. In Dynamics, we use notes most commonly for tracking some of the basic updates for the customer or customer or the activities or some actions to be taken on the customer. So the notes analysis provides you the suggestions based on the inputs provided by the users, that what kind of next action could be or next activity could be performed on this particular record, right? So here it allows you to quickly go and create an activity based on in a single click from the notes that has been entered into your system. Now, another thing which we have is the relationship insights, which is another very good feature, which actually touch bases to so many different applications or the power platforms that gets you the insights from, say, Exchange Online, from your Dynamics 365, and it gives you some insights. Now, what kind of these insights are? The analytics help, which gives you the information about how is your health in terms of communication with this particular customer. What are the different KPIs based on other customers or what are the organization level KPIs for this particular customer. So that kind of KPIs are provided. It also goes and suggests you some of the actions that can be taken to improve the health, right? So these are some of the analytics health which you'll be looking at. Then we have talking points, which is actually a feature where it tells you like what should be my next communication, or if I'm going to go and interact with the customer or the contact in near future. So what could be my ice-breaking conversation? And that identifies, like, it depends on what I have tracked into my application based on the email communications. Like if someone has gone to see some sports, like football match or say movie or some other places they have tracked. So based on that, how you should start your communication when you interacting with the customer after that particular activity has happened or that that time has passed. Like, so that is talking points, which will be explained. Then we have Who Knows Zoom, which is another great feature, which tells you about who is or who are the persons who are interacting with the customers and who has really good relationship health with that particular contact or a lead or a customer, and which can help the users in getting introduced to such contacts so that they can go and close their deals more easily, or if they need any help in closing their deals faster, they can use this Who Knows Zoom as the feature. Now, in near future, there are a lot more updates coming into Who Knows Zoom. So by the time you might spin your environments or say you review this one, you might see some good features coming up than what I'll be showcasing today. Then the major topic where we'll be spending good amount of time is the predictive models. So earlier we used to only have like the customer ask was, I want to see how my predictions in terms of my deals closures or percentage of deal closures or what are the scores for, if I have to provide some scores to my leads or opportunities based on some insights or AI ML models, how that can be provided. So earlier we only had, say, probability or the rating as the fields to track onto your leads and opportunities. But now what Microsoft has introduced is these predictive models, where Microsoft runs their AI and ML models in the behind. It goes and identifies or validates some data for a specific period of time and generate these scores for leads and opportunities. So that's how the lead scoring models are there. Opportunity scoring models are there. They are pretty configurable, which I'll take you through. And one of the another feature with these predictive models is premium forecasting, where the feature showcases how we can go and identify what is my forecast for my specific period, which I have designed, like for a year or 6 months. That too, again, there can be different forecasting models, like my organization or customer or the custom models. So that will be looking at. So these are the major items which you'll be looking at. So I'll quickly go and jump onto the demo. Let me stop this one. I'll just share my screen with you again. So do you have any queries meanwhile when I go and share the actual screen? I think I have lost my mouse. Give me a moment. Just minimize this one. Let me know once you can see my screen. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Now, before I get into the application, I'll take you through how you can go and configure these features. Okay, and what we have with that. So when you go into Sales Hub, which is the default app which has the Sales Insights feature as of now, but that can be replicated to any of your custom apps as well if you want. But by default, when you go and configure any trial or the instance, the features, Sales Insight features, are available only with Sales Hub app, and all the widgets and tabs that gets added as a part of this deployment are added to Sales Insights forms, which are as a separate forms for the records. Now we have different sections over here. If you see Sales Insights settings as well as the app settings and personal settings. Now there is a big difference. Sales Insights settings will be only available to the administrators. Personal settings will be available to the users to go and perform or configure some of the personal level settings for Sales Insights features. Okay, so that's how it is. And there are then app settings where you can actually, this can be made available to the users or to the some higher security roles so that they can go and configure some of these features. So we'll get into Sales Insights settings first. So what we have to do when we have to go and start our Sales Insight features, by default, we get, as I said, the base features are available, but when you have to go and configure your premium features, so at the initial time, you get an option over here to configure premium features, which you have to check as a checkbox. And once you say, I agree and submit, so it takes almost say 15 to 20 minutes, sometimes might 30 minutes to enable your trial instance or your instance for these particular features. Now, once there is a very good feature is that you can actually go and see the overview of all the features over here. And when it comes to a start setting up the complete Sales Insights, so you can start with your setup where it gives you a kind of guided actions where you can start with the one action, then you can go and configure and complete your Sales Accelerator settings. In the overview, you get the default settings for all the things. Like if you want to say Sales Accelerator, you can go into manage if it is anything. So these are the direct links to the other areas over here. Okay, now starting with the Sales Accelerator. What we do generally, and what is actually the part of Sales Accelerator? The heart of the Sales Accelerator is these sequences. Now, what are the sequences? Sequences are nothing but these are the processes, or you can say these are the actions that are designed by your management or by your managers, and that automatically goes and creates the activities in the backend based on certain criteria. Okay, so earlier you might have used workflows or the Power Automates for creating certain activities based on actions that have happened on the leader opportunities. Okay, now how it works. So I have created this one sequence over here. So what sequence is, if you'll see, it is again kind of a flow kind of thing over here where we can go and define some criteria over here where I have defined that if my lead or my opportunity, this is actually for a lead. So if my lead is say created, what should be my first action? Again, when we say how it will get triggered. So what we can have over here is the segments. So users can go and create a segment. Segments are nothing but the criteria which you can provide. Again, it is pretty configurable that if you go into a segment, you can give a name to the segment. Like I'll say leads from phone call. You can select the record type over here, whether it is applicable for lead or opportunity. You can say next. And here, like we have into our advanced find, you can go and define the criteria. What should be your criteria? And when this segment, as well as the sequences that are part of these segments, will get applied to that particular records. So here you can go and define my lead source. My lead source say equals phone call. It is not there. Okay, so I'll say trade show or seminar. I'll say save. you can go and add so many other conditions, combinations, all these ones over here. The reason behind this is when we go and activate such features, if we didn't provide the criteria correctly, the sequence, there might be certain conditions where that conditions might fulfill two or three segments. Now, in that case, what will happen? That particular lead or that opportunity will not get added to any of the sequence. Okay, and that will be a standalone, and users might thought why it is not applied. It's because there might be some confusion with the which segment or which sequence it should apply, and it will not get applied over there. Now, once you go and define this one, so what happens on the sequences, we have an option to define this sequence should be applied to which of the segments or the segment. So here it shows you how many segments that are connected to this particular sequence. So here if you see, I have one segment, which is a web leads, where I have selected lead source as a web, right? You can have multiple segments over here. In this sequence only, you can see what are the different leads that have been automatically added or manually added. Now here you can see connect lead option over here. So if an admin or the manager thinks there is a lead that needs to be part of this particular sequence, we can always go and manually select that particular lead from the list of leads and manually bring that lead as a part of this particular sequence. Or else, the same option is also available on the lead form. If that lead is not part of any sequence, or if it is part of sequence, that can be switched. So that's how we can go and create the sequence, or we can work on the sequence. Now we were at the time where we are at the sequence. So what we have done, when we get an email, when we create a lead which has source as a web, so we are sending an email automatically from here. Again, what the best part is, based on the actions on the earlier activities, you can define your next actions. Like, we'll advance to a next step after 1 day. Okay, this is kind of a wait condition that has been applied, that the application will wait for 1 day and check if email is read by customer or not. If yes, it will initiate a call, means it will create a phone call, and this will be the title of that phone call, this will be description, and it will again check whether the call was made, means it was received or made by the user or not, or the received by the customer or not. It will go and update some field over here. Okay, so the sequences, they are not only about creating the activities, but they can also go and update some information on your records depending on what action is taken or what activities are closed. Here, if we say the status is not made, so no, again, we can add another way which we have added over here, and then we can update and go and update some of the fields. Now, not all the features available here, like directly going and updating the status of the record, but you can go and update some of the fields on the records. Now, it's not only about creating activities from here. So if I just go and quickly edit this same sequence only. So recently, Microsoft have added some other actions over here. So here you can see we have different steps that can be added, like we can send an email, automated email, then we can create a phone call task, we can add some wait condition over here. Again, you can call another sequence from this sequence, like it is again parent-child workflow, which you must be aware of, or else you can go and update the fields. Here you can define your conditions, like if it is my previous activity was say email, that's why it is showing me actions related to the email, whether a person clicked on the link or not, attachment or downloaded or not, or if it is a field value or process stage. So this kind of actions could be there. If it is not a lead anything, so you can see some different actions over here as well. Okay, and recently what is added is if you are using your LinkedIn Sales Navigator along with your sales premium licenses or sales enterprise licenses, so you can also go and initiate the LinkedIn related actions as well. Like you can go and research something, you can send a connect kind of message to the customer, you can say get introduced, you can send email as well. But for this, you should have your sales navigator, LinkedIn sales navigator enabled. So this is how you can go and define your sequence. Now I'll go and exit this update. I'll just quickly go and check and how it works. I'll quickly go and show you. Okay. Now what happens when I'll just quickly go and duplicate this tab. So on my lead creation, now this is my sequence. When I go to leads and I create any lead where I give us lead source as email, so it will automatically get connected to this particular sequence. So if I say go to sales and leads, I'll quickly go and create a new lead over here. It's taking a time. Lead, babe. I'll say first name as of E. B. I'll send some email. So great. Big and great model.com brother. Company name, I'll leave it as it is. I'll say lead source as web. I'll quickly go and save this particular lead. Now this lead will be part of my sequence, and what happens after that? So once it is saved, it will be part of my sequence, and I get, okay, now here I can see connect sequence button over here, which I mentioned that it can be manually added as well as it can be automatically added, and it just refresh, it will take say a couple of seconds or maximum a minute to get it connected to that particular sequence. And whatever was my first activity, that activity will be performed over here, like the email will be sent to the customer, right? And if by any chance, say these leads is not connected to my sequence, someone can actually go and click on that connect sequence button over here, and they can connect to the specific sequence. Now you'll see the email got automatically sent over here. By default, if you don't want to follow this sequence, you think that this sequence is not actually going to work with your lead or opportunity, you can always click on this disconnect sequence. So whatever next actions that are designed for this particular sequence, that will not be applicable for this particular lead or opportunity. Okay. So, and when you go and click on connect to sequence, it will show you all the active sequences available for that records, and you can identify which is the best available sequence for your lead or opportunity. Okay, I'll quickly go and cancel this. Now, this is not the only feature of Sales Accelerator. As I said, what is the best feature of Sales Insights is it gives you a place. Rather, I'll go to my home. Now, once you go and apply the Sales Accelerator or enable the Sales Accelerator, by default, when you use Dynamics 365 application without Sales Insights, we used to get into dashboards, but here it actually takes you to the Sales Accelerator. Now, what is the major feature of Sales Accelerator is sequences and segments. These are just the background configurations, but what it does, it actually gives you the prioritized items over here, which tells you, okay, these are your major items or major activities which you have to follow. And what on top of this, it shows you. It gives you, okay, there is a phone call that has been pending or due for today. Okay, now this actually you used to see into activities, but you cannot go and see the other details of that particular lead. Now, what other details we see over here? What is my next activity? Here only I can see my other timeline and all things. I can actually go and check lead score, which I'll explain later on as well. what is who knows whom and all, and other things I can go and see into my lead over here. Okay, what is my relationship index with this particular lead and how? So I can actually go and get into this particular record and I can say mark this activity as a complete. Okay, now what happens when I say mark this activity as a complete? So my this particular activity actually goes from this particular list. Now there are two things over here. You have an option to define the settings, whether you want to automatically remove that activity from your list of records or not, and that can be designed, and that are kind of your personal settings for this particular. I think there's some issue. Let me refresh. So what it does, it actually automatically removes that activity from the list, and you have to complete all your rest of the activities from the list. Okay, let it load. I think it was open since quite a time, so it refreshed again. Right, so here you can say mark this as a complete from here, or mark this complete from that particular record. From anywhere you can mark that particular activities as a complete, and once you say mark as a complete, actually it goes out of this particular list, and that settings as I was showing, this can be configured into your. Got it. So here you'll see it automatically got removed from here, and this is the way you can actually go and say I want to complete this activity, this activity, this activity, and now my work items, I have completed my work items over here. You can also go and filter out the details. You can actually check which are the unopened records, which are the record, if you want to filter out by opportunity record type, like opportunity or lead or any other record type, you can go and do. If you want to see specific type of activities to be performed, you have an option of filter out over here. So these are the things I was talking about, the settings which actually takes gives you some options to personalize this sequence, these activities, and how it should be, whether you still want to see them, like your availability. Again, the Sales Insight or Sales Accelerator actually supports your availability based on your calendar and your whether you are present or not. Okay, and whether you want to move them from the record or you want to stay on the same record. Okay, here if I say automatically go to the next work item, automatically go to the next work item, or if you want to still stay, so that kind of things you can go and save over here as a personal settings. Okay, so these are what you have with the Sales Insight. So do you have any questions or queries over here in the Sales Accelerator? Okay, I think no questions as of now. Okay, great. So I'll move to the next part. Okay, now what's my next part in the Sales Accelerator? Okay, these are some preview features which I am not touching up. So this is how we can go and set up sequences, segments, and all. The next part is your Assistant Studio, where Assistant Studio has two parts. One is the base cards, another is the custom cards. Okay, now base cards, you will see list of all your cards over here, and you can actually go and see whether they are turned off or turn on. Okay, and admin have an option to go and turn off the cards for organization. Okay, or enable for the organization. So here you can see I can go and turn off the card. If I want to edit the card, I can go and edit. Now this particular card is the base card, which I have no right to edit, except I can go and turn it off. So most of the base cards, they cannot be edited to a certain, or can be edited to very limited extent. Okay, but when I see my this card, which is my custom card, which I have created, and I will show you how you can go and create the custom cards as well. So that can be customized, and we can go and apply our own requirements on top of it. Now what happens with this particular part is, with Sales Insights personal settings, there are almost 30 plus cards which Microsoft provides as of now. Here you can see this is a turn off card. So if user thinks that these are kind of a killing my dashboard or killing my task, and I'm not able to focus on my actual activities which I should look at. So users can go into their personal settings and they can see this inside cards over here, and they can manually turn off this card for themselves. Okay, now when we say for themselves, so for all rest of the users, this cards will still be running and there will be no impact for other users, and these cards will not be visible to the user who have turned them off for themselves. Okay, now where your custom insight cards or your cards are shown, so when you go into dashboard, in your sales activity dashboard, Microsoft has added this assistant pane, or wherever you find this assistant pane, you will see all your cards, assistant cards over here. Okay, and you can always go and open that cards. It has some actions given, like if you want to open that email or not, you can always go and do these things, or you can at certain point of time, if you don't want to see any of these actions, you can go and dismiss all, which will actually go and dismiss all these cards, and that will not be popped up to you unless it is triggered again. Okay, so that's how you can go and see these cards. Now, if you see, there are different actions like open email, open opportunity, or some other like open contact suggestions, because these cards has their own features, and depending on each card, it gives you action. Like if you want to open opportunity directly from this card, this is my opportunity closes on Friday, so I want to see which is my opportunity which is getting closed. So quickly through your dashboard itself, you can actually go and get into an opportunity and work on that particular opportunity, take necessary actions to close that particular opportunity, right? So these are your cards that are defined. Now, how we can go and the first thing, the base cards and custom cards that are explained. Now, to design your own cards, what you have to do is it actually use those in the backend, and it use one premium connector which is called as a custom insight cards connector. There are 2-3 versions, but you should always go and use the latest version. What we have done for this one and what is the requirement, so we considered that if my opportunity is say having worth more than $5 million, so it should trigger an insight card or the notification to the manager of the user. So here we have written one workflow on the creation. You can define all your criteria. You can go and check the estimated revenue if it is not null, and if it is greater than 5 million, so it will go and check, get the manager details, and it will go and create a notification for the manager. Now this is one action which we create over here, like which action should be used. If you go into this one, and if you search for insight cards, so here you will find V3 as the insight card. Okay, sorry. So create card for assistant, which is V3, you should use that. And what kind of properties we have option to give over here, like you can go and define the organization environment. And there's a card name which is shown. There's a card. This card name is not shown anywhere. This is a card header, which is kind of a title which is shown. The text which shown over here. So if I take here, so this is your card header. This is the text which you want to showcase over here. And we can give some primary actions over here, like you want to open the record or launch playbook or some other actions, or open the URL. So that actions can be provided over here. And which is the entity or which record, if it is say open record, so which record should be opened, so you can go and pass on the parameters, or you can define your own actions over here, and that card will work accordingly. Now I'll quickly go and close this one. I'll not save, and I'll show you how it actually runs. So we had actually run this for one of the users. Now if I quickly go and share you the manager details with you, this is the sales manager. So if you can see, this is the another window over here, for which I'll go on to my dashboard, and the card, the how the card looks like. Is it gives you a notification. I think I have dismissed that one. I'll quickly go and create one opportunity with 5 million plus revenue, and the action or the notification will be shown to the manager over here. Just give me a moment. Or rather, create a new opportunity. So actually, here I can share. This is my salesperson login, where I'm creating a new opportunity. Now this card, okay, again, on the card, it is visible to a specific person, and that is also defined on when you go and define your card. So it's not all cards will be visible to all the users. The cards will be specifically shown to users for whom they have been created. Opportunity above. I'll select customer here. Any estimated revenue. Million. Done. Okay, so this is my salesperson. My manager is a sales manager. The moment I go and save and close this one, so this particular card will not be showcased to me even if I have created the opportunity. So the card will be shown to the manager over here. If I go and refresh my things, I need to first check and whether the flow has run or not. All runs. Okay, so 13 seconds ago, if I go and see this one over here, you will find it has taken all the considerations and it has created the card. Okay, now this is how it has created. Like, card name is this, opportunity your colleague has created, have created the card, and all these things are connected over here. If I go here into my manager login, rather I'll go and open the opportunity. It is not showcasing here. Open opportunities. So when I go over here and my assistant, so see this one, this card came to me. Somehow it is not getting refreshed. So here, this was my card title, and here it shows me. And if it comes on my dashboard, I can actually go and click on this open record. It will actually open this opportunity record in front of me. So that's how your custom insight cards and base cards work. Any queries on custom insight cards or base cards?
There are no queries.
Okay, great. I'll quickly move to the next part, which is productivity, in which we have four major items. Conversation intelligence is one of the item which is not actually configured over here, but just to give an overview about what is conversation intelligence is, it actually goes and reads through your communications. When I say reads through your communications, it actually is integrated with your Teams calls. It actually goes, reads, or say listens to your communications based on certain keywords that are defined into our configurations. It goes and creates some intelligence on top of that. So that is what it is, but for that it requires to have Teams integrations along with having capabilities to make a calls from the Teams as a mobile. So, and each user should have their specific numbers given, and so many configurations are required for that. So that's where which was not possible during this demo. So that's not configured over here, but that's how the conversation intelligence works. Now, to store all these call recordings, it actually uses your Azure blob storage. And based on that, what happens actually, you can define which competitors or which users you are tracking this particular conversations, any specific keywords you want to identify from the communication, so that not all communications will give the priorities, only the keywords. If you find that keyword, it will work for them. And other things are already there as a part of conversational intelligence. Now, how it shows you the data can actually open one window for you, and what actually it shows as a part of insights is in your conversation intelligence. It gives you a kind of a KPI where it tells you about what your customers are talking about. Now, because it is not configured, this particular page is not coming up over here. But if I want to see Teams overview over here, I can see what are the overall sentiments from the communications based on the keywords that are part of your communication. How many of the communications were positive, how many were the negative or kind of a neutral by seller. Seller is no one but your salesperson actually, and over the time how your sentiments have changed. Now, because this instance was configured to November 2021, that's where all the sentiments are the same one, and how many percentage it was about talking, how many percentage it was about listening, any talking speed, how it was like 221 words per minute, and were there any switches per call, where there's pause taken, where longest customers monologues, that all that kind of things can be given over here. Here, if I go to seller details, as I said, seller is no one but the users. So it gives me an overview of this particular seller. What was the listen ratio? What was the talking speed? And all the things are there. Okay, and here I can actually see the call history altogether. Okay, and for that particular call, how was my sentiment? Okay, so that things are shown over here. Now, this is a dummy data. That's why you might see it is coming as a same across. But you can actually go and see that particular records as well over here. Okay, so that's how Microsoft has built this particular tool, and it allows you to actually listen that particular records as well as if you at any point of time if you want to see that activities, also that activities can be opened from your list of calls as well. So no major exposure on this. So that's what I have. I could expose on this one. So this is what the conversion intelligence is. I'll click go and close this one. Now, another thing what we have in the next is auto capture, which is another good feature, where what auto capture does is it actually goes and connects to your Exchange Online, and it gives you an option where whether you want to track that emails or the activity meetings into your Office 365 in your D365 or not. Now the good part of this one is if I go to any of my accounts, I'll quickly go and open up this one. So in auto capture, it gives me these suggestions whether this activity or can we track this activity into my Dynamics 365 or not. If I'm at say one of the lead, and if that lead has sent me an email, there is an appointment that has been scheduled, which I have not tracked over here, that emails can be tracked into Dynamics. So I had one contact with me. I'll just quickly go and search. Okay, sorry, it was a lead, not a contact. So if I say V Patil, okay, and I had sent one email. So here it shows me the activity suggestions. So if you'll see, what happens over here, the best part is when you track the email, it actually comes and sits into your application. But if there is an email which has come, you whether you want to track it or not, you have an option over here, but it gives you suggestions. Okay, whether this should be tracked or not. And auto tracking is if it is enabled. Now, this is what it happens over here. Okay. So this actually works for your emails, meetings or contacts. When it comes to contacts, if say there is an email which has received from your from a person which is not part of your Dynamics 365, so instead of having tracked this email, it actually tells you whether you want to convert it into a contact or tag this as a contact. Okay, so that kind of features are part of your auto capture. Email engagement, which is another a major ask which is delivered by Microsoft as a part of premium features. Now what happens, okay, for this as a configuration, no much technical coverage is required. So you have to just toggle these parts. You can allow specific security rules that can use these features, or but for the demo I had used as all security rules. Same happens for email engagement, and same is for your notes analysis, where there is no major configuration required. Okay. But in the backend, it requires some of the consents from the Dynamics or global admin or Exchange admin, because it actually goes and gets into your Exchange Online. Now, how email engagement works. So if say I am using this particular lead, and if I want to send out some email from here to this particular lead, so what option it gives me that I can follow this particular email, or I don't want to follow this particular email. By default, when we enable this, so by default, all the emails we can go and say follow, but at a personal level, users can go and say I don't want to follow. So there are the separate settings for that. Okay, now here, instead of using anything of this, I'll use the template so I can give some more information about this. I'm using one template, GBAD only, where we have multiple links, and what it does, what kind of things it tracks is, it actually goes and tracks whether the email is sent, the sent email is received by the customer or not, whether it has opened or not, whether they clicked on a link or not, and if there are any attachments, whether they were downloaded or not, as well as if someone replied to that particular email or not. Now what I'll do, I'll quickly go and click on the send over here. Now once this email is sent out of the application, I can go and see whether that particular email is reached or not. So this is my email. If I go here now, so here you'll see there is the recipient activities, whether email is opened or not, attachment views or not, link where clicks or not, and if there was any reply from the customer or not. Now if I look at the email address that has been sent, it's my Gmail. Let me quickly check into my Gmail account. When I open this email, what happens? Okay, again, there is another good feature in your email engagement is actually it shows you all the actions or the activities as a timeline manner over here. Must be into my trash spam. Okay, I got it. The spam. It's inbox. Okay, right. Now I have opened this particular email. If I go and refresh this particular page, it takes a few seconds or a few minutes to reflect this particular actions over here, as I have just opened my email onto my personal mailbox. I'll click few of the links which are part of this email, like Global Biz Apps Weekend. I'll click on the register one as well. Okay, and once that particular pages are loaded, I'll keep this refreshing. Okay, so now what it will do, or it shall do actually, it should show me if there are multiple participants. It will show me how many people have opened this particular email, how many actual link clicks has happened. Like I have clicked on two links, when these will get synced back, which will take say 2 to 5 minutes. So here it will have one open and two link clicks. Once I go and reply to this particular email, which I'll do right away, so the reply count will also get increased over here. And so the invite. Say same. So this reply count will also get added as a one. Now, as a part of my timeline, what it will show me? It will show me when it was opened, when the link was clicked, first link, when the second link was clicked, when the reply had received or say done by the customer. So still not reflected. So we'll move to the next part and we'll refresh this in another couple of minutes to showcase you this one. Now the third part is the notes analysis. What it does in the notes analysis is whenever we go and try to add some notes onto my lead or opportunity. Actually, it goes and gives me some suggestions. What should be my next action on this particular note? So here, if I say I want to enter a note. Okay. Let me just replace this one. Enter note. So title, I'll let it load. Okay, customers asked to schedule meeting next week. Now what happens over here, it actually goes and keeps identifying which are the type of activities, like meeting is an appointment, phone call is the phone, or a call is the phone call, email is the email, that kind of activities it goes and checks. I can quickly go and say add the note over here. And once it is saved, the application gives me and feedback saying, okay, you should go and because based on this particular communication or the note you have added, this should be your next action. If I just quickly go and refresh this one. Okay. So it will make this as a blue. This color will be a kind of a blue, and where it will give you, it will suggest you the this one. Like here, I had added qualification column. Okay, I'll just quickly go and refresh this timeline again. Record. Let me see. By the time this one, if it is refreshed. Okay, see this one. Now actually I had opened this email twice, so it's showing me the email was opened twice. Okay, the email was again opened by Vivek. Vivek actually clicked on this link first, then on this link again Vivek opened, and Vivek actually replied. Okay, so this is how it shows me a complete timeline as well for email attachments. When you go and download, or the customer downloads, it actually also shows you the email attachment has been downloaded or not. Okay, so if you want to see view reply over you, the moment you click, it will actually see thanks for the invite, regards Vivek, it will take you there. Okay, so that's how actually it gives you a complete timeline along with this one. I'll quickly go switch over here whether it is shown me or not. Okay, I think it's it actually, if you come over here and if you click over here, it actually opens up a small window which mentions that okay, you want to you need to create a meeting or say phone call. So that's how it works. There might be some issue with this one, that's why it's not working. So any queries on this one, because we have completed the productivity features?
There are no queries.
Okay, great. Now the another next part, I know I have only 16 minutes left, so I'll try to complete this one. Analytics and health is another feature which Microsoft has provided, where again it is only enablement feature, no major configurations required because everything happens in the background. So I have to say enable these two things, and it actually what it influences this kind of activities. What should be my communication frequency with the customer? So you have an option to define certain of the things over here. You can actually define your grade scorings onto your own, whether you want to, if based on the percentage, how you want to define your help with the customer. By default, these are the rates which are defined by the application. And once you say save, the relationship insights is actually starts building. Now, the relationship insights actually takes to build these scores on the first time 24 hours, and it actually runs every 24 hours and give you the analytics into your sales insights form. And when you go and visit any of your customer, it tells you about how the relationship insights is. Now these are some of the KPIs. By default it shows you 4 KPIs, right? Here you have it tells you have initiated more 3 more calls compared to the customer. You have invested 54 minutes lesser compared to the customer, means customer is actually investing more times. You take two more hours to respond emails compared to the customer. It means customer is faster than you. Your rate of response is emails 4% higher compared to the customer. Okay. Now these KPIs can give you some insights about where you are lacking and where customer is lacking or what needs to be improved. And to support these things, it actually gives you some of the insights. Now here, it tells you about the client contacts where majorly of the interactions are happening. So here it shows multiple contacts, max 2-3. Okay. So even if you have say 5, 10 or 100 contacts, it will always take top 3 contacts, which are part of the communications, as well as when we say contours of contacts. Okay. You might say, see some variations over here, but these are not actually the contacts. These are actually the use application users who are interacting with these particular people over here. Okay. So don't try to count these accounts with these ones, because organization level count will be shown over here, and here it will only show contact specific counts. Now here it shows the interactions, what kind of activities are performed and what are the levels. Like here, there are 7 emails from our side, there are 6 emails from customer side, there are no meetings, there are 3 phone calls from our side. How much time is invested by whom? So here it shows you how much time is invested by whom. Now, how they calculate this particular time. So for email, if it is sent, it considers as a 5 minutes efforts. If it is received and read, it considers as 2.5 minutes. Okay, so that's how it works for the email. For all other activities, whatever is the actual duration, like your phone call, for your meeting or for your task, it takes the actual duration which user goes and mentions on that particular activities. Again, there is a another email engagement level feature, like how many emails were opened by us, how many were by them. Actually, by them is nothing here, and attachments viewed, links clicked. Now this is again a dummy data, but that's how it shows to you. Responses in terms of impact success is 5 hours. We take customer takes only 3 hours. Okay, so that's how, which is the KPI which also mentioned over here, that you take 2 more hours to respond and customer is faster than you. How responsive you are and how responsive the customer is, that it shows. And it also shows you some of the historical information, like on what date or what period, how the interactions have happened, right? So it gives you all the details on September 23, how many on these many days, what has happened. So this particular relationship insights actually gives you the connection, or you can say relationship help with the customer. There is another small widget you might see at lead sometime, that it tells you about your health. Like here, if you see, this is a small widget which tells you how the health with this particular customer. So it says poor, relationship and steady. And the reasons, like there is no next action, or the last interaction was very early, and that kind of things can be shown over here. So that's how the relationship insight actually works, and it shows the analytics. Talking points is actually, as I mentioned, that is not configured actually as a widget, but what it does, it actually tells you about what should be my next communication, or when I start communicating with the customer, like we do our with our friends, depending on their status, depending on their activities, whether they had gone to a clinic or they were admitted, they had operated, if it is family functions or anything, depending on such keywords, or if sometime they have mentioned in the email that I'm going to watch a football match, and that kind of a sports event. If it is entertainment, like I had seen this movie, which was really great. That kind of communication, generally in a business, we don't do that kind of communications, but still, if you have that kind of relationship with the customers, so actually you can start your communication based on that communication that had happened, and that makes a kind of your communication smooth and more relative. Who knows whom is another feature which I had explained, and I'll quickly jump onto that particular part where it shows me who knows whom part over here. So if I come to this particular lead, this is my who knows whom widget. Now, what does Who Knows Whom does is it gives me the contacts, actually five contacts as of now. The new feature which is coming up, it will give you all the contacts which are coming up with actually interacting with that particular customer. Here it shows you a battery indicator where it shows how the strength of this particular person, which is from your organization, which is your colleague, has with this particular lead or with this particular customer. So here Alan has a best or the topmost strength with the customer, where Ali is having a kind of fair. And here is a poor, but there are some communications or a weak communication that can happen. Now, what a user can do if this particular customer somehow is part of any of their lead or they want to get connected with this particular lead or person, they can click on this get introduced and they can actually go and say, send an email from here, or they can send a message from here to your colleague that, can you please introduce me to this particular person? You can customize your message and you can be a specific, right? How and why you want to connect with this particular customer. So this is a part of your Who Knows Whom over here. Any questions on relationship analytics?
Vivek, I don't see any questions in the chat window.
Right. So I'll go and move to the final thing, which is predictive models and lead scoring, which I have already configured. What it does, it again runs the models behind. It takes your data for training the model. Now we can go and define for how much data or how much, what period of data you want to train your models. So here I have considered 2 years. For last 2 years, maximum is 2 years data on which we can go and run our models. Now here I can go and see, here I can see my model is published over here, and based on the model's consideration, these are the score grading that has happened. Like 0 to 70%, they are falling into grade D, 73 is the grade, which are grade C, 74 grade is this. So this is how it tells you. It also gives you some KPIs, like 0% of leads in this category are qualified, 100% of leads in this category are qualified, 94% leads in this category are qualified. So these are kind of KPIs that are built automatically by the AI and ML model. Now, because we have allowed this model to train automatically, now if, and these 12 attributes which it considers for modeling is based on the models or the AI or ML logic they have selected. But if I want to anytime modify my model, or I want to give my fields over here, okay, so I can go and edit my model over here and actually define on which fields my model should run. Now here we can get the list of all leads attributes over here, because I'm into lead model. So here it shows me a prediction influence. What it does is actually for each field, when we first run the predictive scoring models, it builds their attribute insights, where it tells us what is the qualification rate for these particular fields. Like if I select this field, how many percentage or for what value, what was the qualification rate. So prediction is influence for this particular field is high. This field is populated with 39% open leads. This field is populated in 60% of closed leads. Okay, and for even for within that particular field's values, if it is a Wi-Fi service required, it is say 100, closed leads are 13, here it is 11, here it is this. And based on even values within that particular field, it tells you what could be my predictions, what could be my scores that is coming up on this one. So here you can see this one prediction influence is coming. You can check and identify which fields you want to make part of your lead scoring models so that your lead score gets calculated correctly. Here, if it is say medium, though here my low, blank and high, it shows some values over here. But what it does is prediction influences medium, because the field is populated in 37% of open leads, and this field is only populated only in 10% of closed leads. So that's where the prediction influence for this particular field is medium. as a part of recommendations, one should not use medium or low kind of fields for your predictions. Medium still can be used if you have if you don't have much of the high influence fields, but low influence level fields should not be added. Otherwise, what will happen in your leads and opportunities, it will always show you a grade as a D, or your score will be at a lower side. Okay, but if you actually correct your fields over here, the lead scores can be given in a correct manner. Now you can also select some of the fields from, say, another type of records, which is your customer, okay, like your account contact. And there are some intelligent fields which are called as domain validation, first name, and all these things. Okay, and you can go and say retrain my model based on my new selection of fields. So that's how you can go and manually go and return, define your own fields. Okay, and that can be published. And from next time, whenever the scores will get calculated, that should be calculated based on these attributes that are selected over here. The same thing happens with your opportunity as well. So when you go and define the fields, again, here we have the system has automatically selected only three fields, which they find which are at the high, they must be at the high influential level. And that's why they selected only that. Otherwise, see, here there are only these ones. And I think there must be some other field from the account or contact, which might have been considered as the part of scoring model. So that's how, by default, when you run the predictive scoring model at the very first time, it considers their own attributes. Later on, you can go and build your own models, as well as you can add multiple models as well over here. But the thing is, if you have multiple models, you should be very much careful about defining the filters. If you don't define the filters, and if there is, say, conflict between the two models criteria, the lead or opportunity might take any of the lead models to show their scores. Here again, depending on the range of the months or days, how many months or how many days records you want to calculate, scoring these models, that can be defined. Again, the caveat is, for any scoring model, it should have 40 closed or 40, like if it is say opportunity, it should have 40 won, 40 lost, and 40 open opportunities. Same for lead, it should have 40 qualified, 40 disqualified, and 40 open leads to calculate this course. Otherwise, this gets started, but you will find that as a blank. That too, again, for this particular period of time. So if you have selected 2 years, it should have that count within last 2 years. Looking at the time, I'll quickly move to the premium forecasting. What we get with the forecasting, this was another ask, that we cannot go and forecast what is my closure rate over the period, or what how my team is actually performing. So what happens with this forecast? Actually,
a minute away from 7 o'clock, just to remind you.
Yeah, I'll just quickly go and get into the forecasting model, and I'll show how forecasting works actually. Okay, so here I'll go and get into my forecast. So when you go to Sales Hub, into your forecast, you can see this forecast model that you have defined or designed, and how the forecasts are done. I have just configured the org level forecast over here. Let it load probably. Okay, and when I say org level forecast, means at the top I have considered as the CEO. Okay, I'll just go and change these to October, November. Okay. So here my CEO, what is the forecast, what is the own value, what is committed, and all. So all these things can be seen for all the users. And if you have well designed hierarchy over here, so you can see for all your users, like for salesperson 1, 2, and how it is getting calculated. Also, you can go and add some drill downs over here, which I have not enabled. And that's how you can actually go and see how your forecast is working you can go and define the quotas over here. By default, it is showing as a zero, but you can go and apply the quota as you need. You can see it into a multi-currency as well, and you can automatically gets changed based on that. So even if you have, say, multi-geographical locations, you can actually see your forecast into multiple currencies. Extremely sorry, I had to run at a very fast in the last few minutes. But if you have any queries, I'll be there in the chat window to respond to your queries. So this is what we have with the forecast. If you have any queries, please reach out to me. I'll not switch over to my presentation right now, but you can get my credentials. You can just search for me as Vivek Patil on LinkedIn, or you can just reach out to Champs for any other clarifications. So thank you, everyone, and sorry, organizers, I took some extra time.
Thank you, Vivek, for taking the time. Very detailed session, so it can be a go-to guide for people exploring sales insights for sure. So thank you, Vivek.